time to cross the road. And Alan, why aren't you standing outside the AGM? Because it's cold.
Because leave them standing outside. That's
because it's cold and they won't tell you anything until they're ready anyway.
And because I need to sit here and speak to you too. That's the main reason.
Sorry.
No, it's, AGM day, deadline day. So the perfect day to be recording a podcast before any of these things happen. So that just it's immediately out of date. That's what you're after.
Rather than listen to another failed old firm or Aberdeen or Hibs or Hearts transfer this evening, the Dundee United fans can listen to the podcast, be monitoring their phone and just, you know, press pause when news comes through of a United centre half.
It's a funny deadline day because although it's not optimal to be talking about it when people might be listening to this after the deadline has already passed, I don't expect it to be a particularly hectic one. I don't think this will be a case of four signings are going to make this terribly out of date. United know exactly what they want and they might get it or they might not, but there's not a sense of panic or scrambling or what it was last season, which was they desperately need anyone. X, Y and Z.
Yeah. They've gone to the stage where anyone would have done all this day.
Well, yeah, perhaps, but they didn't even get that. But this window's been a really solid one. They needed gaps in their squad filled and they filled them with Alec Grieve and David Wotherspoon. Going back to last summer, they built a decent squad with a bit of depth. As I say, they could do with that centre-half because they didn't have a senior centre-back on the bench last weekend, which obviously isn't ideal, but by the same token, Declan Gallagher's fit again in about 2 to 3 weeks, at which point you then have Ross Graham, Kevin Holt and Declan Gallagher. You've got Scott McMahon, who's got experience of playing centre-half, and then you've got younger players who... cards on the table. Although I've seen them at under-18s levels, I've got no idea what happens if you throw a Sam Clayle Harding or a Keir Berthe into the starting lineup. But that's the reality as we've been a championship club. Mm-hmm. We've all seen the financial breakdowns that was in the accounts. So the likelihood that you'll have two options for every single position is slightly ambitious. It's what you would like to have, but if they don't manage to get that by the end of the window, then they'll make do. And I think from speaking to Jim Goodwin earlier this week, he seemed pretty calm about every permutation. So, yeah, they might get that one in. They're certainly still trying and they will be trying until 11:30. And there's a couple of people who I think would perhaps be surplus to requirements if the right option came along. Mark Birigiti's turned down interest from Crewe Alexandra. That's after turning down interest from Bolton Wanderers and Hapoel last summer. So whether or not something happens with him, again, you'll probably know listening to this. Likewise, you've got guys like Kieran Freeman, who I can only imagine is really frustrated, a very capable fullback who's only played 7 games this season and things like that. So there could be a few guys that are... that could have options in the next few hours if clubs do come in for them, which hasn't happened yet. So we're kind of waiting for things to tick into gear at this point. But the overriding message, regardless of what happens when you've listened to this, is that I think United will be fairly comfortable in their squad in the context of a championship season.
I mean, Bear, is this a sign? I mean, I should start this by saying it's hours since I've praised Jim Goodwin, so it's overdue. But it's a sign of the more sensible, calm, practical approach. As Alan said, Jim Goodwin will have signed a centre-half if he's good enough and if he's available by the deadline. If not, he won't panic. Mm-hmm. He'll get on with the job in the way he's got on with the job. And maybe fans possibly still disappointed if one hasn't arrived. But the dressing room remains calm. This time last year, it must have filtered through to the dressing room when there seemed to be a panic about not getting players. It must sow the seeds of self-doubt among at least some players when they go, well, the club were desperate for players.
I would go the other way. If you're a player in the team, do you really want to see another centre-half coming in? You want to... You want to make sure that you're playing every single week. So the fact that they can't get anyone...
But if you're a left winger or a striker and you think you need a centre-half...
Yeah, no, there is
that. And they look desperate to get one.
Of course there is that. And I think, you know, in an ideal world, you know, Jim Goodwin would have had a centre-half in by now. I think the fact that we're on the last hours of the transfer window shows the situation Dundee United find themselves in. It might not be because they're not offering decent money to bring a centre-half in. It might be the fact that players don't want to actually come and play in the championship. Rate.
And they probably don't want to come and play in for a club that, for better or worse, Kevin Holt and Declan Gallagher absolutely have those positions nailed down.
Absolutely.
Come along and be at best third choice centre-back.
There is that. And Jim Goodwin's been cute this week, but I mean, I'm delighted to see Ross Graeme back in the team. I always felt Ross Graeme there's a player in there. He went off the rails a wee bit, and there was a time where he couldn't get himself in the team for one reason or another. He came back, he had a tough time coming back, but he's done well the last couple of games. And I noticed the manager's come out and praised him. And I think there's a couple of things in that. One, he's getting praised because he has done particularly well in these games. But two, Jim Goodwin realises if he doesn't get another centre-half into the club, Ross Graeme might have to feature more often than not between now and the end of the season. He needs to keep that lad's confidence high for all these games. Because, you know, United haven't been setting the heather on fire recently. But the fact is that they're still at the top of the table. They put another point between themselves and Raith Rovers last Saturday. So... That's the positive side of things. They haven't been playing well, but they're still in the situation where they're in charge of their own destiny. So, you know, fingers crossed they can get someone, because I do believe that they do need cover there. But we're down to the nitty-gritty now, Tam. Right. So
But we should stress it's a matter of quantity.
Yeah.
Obviously, quality is always a factor, but they're not desperate for a centre-half in terms of they need somebody who's better than they've got. They've got three that are good. Ideally, you would like four.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, put in simplistic terms, if Ross Graeme or Kevin Holt had got injured at the weekend, then Dundee United would have to probably play Scott McMahon at centre-half, I would have thought.
Either a kid or someone in a position.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the situation. However, I think the pragmatist in you, and, you know, perhaps... you know, in their current situation, United will need to be pragmatic. It tells you that in 2 or 3 weeks, you could be in a position where you've got Kevin Holt, Declan Gallagher, and Ross Graeme, mm-hmm. which is a selection of centre-halves that most clubs in the Championship would be.
Yeah.
Like, as I say, I think it's important to see this in the context of the Championship. Dundee United aren't gearing up for the second half of a Premiership season.
No.
Raith Rovers, by comparison, at times in the first half of the season, lined up with central defence. That had no central defenders in it.
in the Championship.
Just looking at their goals against column.
Life in the Championship is, it's a footballing and financial grind sometimes. And the best case scenario of having quality deputies in every circumstance, in every position, probably isn't likely to be the case. So, I think it's worth remembering that although you might not be in the ideal position in terms of having the depth for every single worst case scenario that could occur, you're still in a pretty good place when you consider the division you're in, and it should be enough. I mean, and defensively isn't really where the issues are at all, or where they have been at any point this season. Getting the team flowing and firing is the thing to do.
That every other Championship club would love to have one of them. But they are Dundee United, so Dundee United want four.
Yeah.
And that's part of being a club that size, isn't it?
And let's be honest, bar a couple of blips, in general, the defence has done really well this season. They keep, regardless, I mean, Saturday wasn't a brilliant performance, but they still managed to keep a clean sheet. And, that gives you great hope. But once the turn in the other direction, once Fotheringham and Mole and Watt start banging in goals, what's the will?
Mm-hmm.
United will start winning games again and start putting the 3 points on the board, which should start moving them away from the pack. Because I've got to say, Raith Rovers, unless they get that defence sorted out, they're not going to finish top of the league.
Jim Goodwin would never say this because it's bad PR and he's a very savvy operator, but I think they'll be delighted to be back on the road this weekend. Because they're struggling at Tannadice to break down what has become quite a familiar challenge, and this shouldn't sound like a criticism or in any way patronising to Dunfermline, but or any other team in the Championship, but they all come to Tannadice and play a similar way, which is really organised banks with very few gaps between the lines to play through. And United have struggled to break that down. That is not... They face it to an extent away from home. Teams aren't coming gung-ho for them, but on home soil, teams won't accept that. There's always a... Well, come on, come out and do something from their own fans, and that filters onto the pitch, and there are more spaces on the road, and you only need to look at the, you know, United's away form is spectacular. Yeah. 8 wins and 2 draws from 10 games is fantastic. So it's
and their home form is a bit disappointing, but one thing it's not for a team at the top of the Championship with their sort of reputation, it's not unique, is it?
No,
because we can pick all sorts of holes in the Championship, but one thing you can never criticise clubs is a lack of organisation.
Ever since they've been seen as bona fide title challengers, Raith Rovers' home record has been poor as well.
Yeah.
Because teams have altered their perception of how to play against Raith Rovers. And yeah, as you're absolutely bang on what you say. Teams in the Championship are more than capable of putting up organising a kind of stoic defensive resistance if that's your kind of primary and sole focus. See, if you say a point is a success from this match, that's a lot easier to set up for. It's a lot harder to go and win a football match than it is to say, do you know what, a point would be a success for us, and if we can win it, if there's a circumstance that allows us to win it, then we'll certainly take that. But it's a lot harder to win a football match than it is to win/draw it, because it totally changes your focus.
In a way, United are victims of their early season big wins, because the Championship is not traditionally a league with high scoring games. Nobody's too surprised that Falkirk have clicked in League One and they're winning games 3, 4 and 5 quite regularly. But historically it was surprising that United, and there have been bigger teams than United in the Championship, were winning 4, 5 and 6 for a few weeks, because Championship teams do not lose a lot of goals.
No, and they did it early doors. They were on over the top of teams. I think Arbroath has won the team they're playing on Saturday. Right?
Yeah.
Was normal. And I think Alan's spot on in his assessment of how teams line up. And, you know, you just wonder if teams will recognise the fact. You wonder if they'd have had their fingers burned from that last game against Dundee United, and maybe... You know, maybe teams may start sitting a bit tighter, but it's hard. It's hard. Area United will have your home fans don't want to see you lined up defensive and just sitting back and allowing any team. Doesn't matter
new
who
manager
they are.
As well.
Yeah, it doesn't matter who they are in the Championship, coming to your own park and dictating. So, obviously there's a Scott Brown factor. They had a good win last week.
Scott Brown doesn't want to park the bus in his first home game, I think it is.
I think one thing it is worth saying, though, because... I think that sort of meandering monologue there made it sound like I was kind of mitigating an awful lot from a Dundee United perspective. They also weren't good enough.
No,
well, let's be absolutely blunt about that. Like, that it's difficult to break down these defences, but it's even more difficult if you don't do the aspects of your job that you can control, which are moving the ball fast, trying to zip through the lines in one pass rather than three. It was too pedestrian. It wasn't good enough. The final ball was bad. The set pieces were poor. All things that you could do to potentially break down that challenge. So while it is a tough challenge and supporters really should acknowledge that, I think there'll be an acceptance within Tannadice that what they did to potentially impose themselves in the game and actually break down that stubborn challenge, they didn't do good enough. So there'll certainly be a demand for better when you consider the absolute, you know, again in the context of the Championship, just a swathe of attacking talent that they've got on the books.
And they're a hard-working squad, aren't they? They don't, and Jim Goodwin demands that, they don't look at it and say, well, this is just the way it is. This is what we'll have to put up with the rest of the season. They'll be looking at ways of making sure they do break down defences.
Yeah, I mean, so you would expect nothing less from a team that Jim Goodwin's in charge of. That's a given that your team's going to run from the first minute to the last minute, but... Sometimes it boils down. You need that wee bit of quality that Dundee United have got in their ranks with Fotheringham. We spoke last week. How was he going to set up? And he gave Tony Watt the nod. Obviously Moult came on. It'll be interesting to see who starts this week. But you need these boys that have got the quality to produce. Sometimes it takes a moment of individual brilliance to open the door for you. And once you've done that, it forces other teams hard. Are they going to sit tight, or are they going to come out? But Alan's right. when you're at home, you do need to look to move the ball just a wee bit quicker at times to expose teams, because they're so well drilled. And we saw, I go back to that game, Dundee against Cove Rangers, when there was almost 10,000 Dundee fans at that game that night. And every to a man thought they were going to run over the top of Cove. And Cove Rangers, a mixture of part-time and full-time players, well drilled, well set up, they get out of there with a point. You know, if Cove Rangers can do it, then the vast majority of teams in that league can do it. And they're going to make life as difficult as possible for you.
Aye, and I mean, teams like that, the only press they're involved in, for all it's the one of the catchwords of the modern game, is when they speak to the press after the game, they ain't coming out their own half in 90 minutes at Tannadice. And you feel for United fans as you would for Dundee fans last season at times, Hearts previously, Rangers, Hibs, and that. Very often it's a frustrating season, not just because you're in the division you don't want to be, but just because of the nature of the games. And you totally understand.
Also, I think it's quite important to, in terms of a sort of bigger picture, looking at it, there's a lot of responses such as, well, if you look at that, then what is this team going to do if it does get promoted? It would be straight back down from the Premiership.
It's a different game.
I just don't think it's in any way relevant. And I think you're talking about Dundee last season. They are the perfect example of that. And there's a lot of comparisons. First of all, you've got 14 senior players out of contract. It would probably be a renewed, recycled Dundee United team that were to come out. But also, the games would look totally different. Mm-hmm. The Premiership football clubs would not come to Tannadice against a newly promoted Dundee United and play the way the Championship clubs do. So I don't think there's any relevance whatsoever. The challenges in the Championship are such as they are, and there will be a lot of frustrating afternoons. The emphasis is just to get out of that division, and then you think about building a team and building a playing style more suited for what you might come up against in the Premiership.
I say to fans, forget about the Premier League.
Yeah.
The most important thing, first and foremost, get yourself out of that Championship. And at this point in time, they're doing what they've got to do. They're at the top of that league. Now, they've not been, setting the heather on fire recently, but neither's Raith Rovers. So there's still a gap between them and Partick Thistle. It's still a two-horse race.
They're not losing well. They're not playing as well as they could. Four points from the last two games when they haven't played the way they wanted to.
Defensive solidity gives you a foundation to go when you do start firing, go and start picking up 3 points again. But, I think they need a couple of things to go for them as well. I think they've been a wee bit unfortunate. The way games have panned out recently. Sometimes, instead of a moment of brilliance, just a corner kick and coming off the back of somebody's head and ending up in the back of the net, that'll do for starters. But it's going to be tough on Saturday. We've seen that Scott Brown comes in and suddenly he gets a result, but you look at the quality in that Dundee United side, you would fancy them a go. They need something to get them going. They need something, a goal, a decision going for a penalty kick, something like that, just to get them breathing a wee bit easier and playing a bit more, taking a bit of the pressure off. I think United, because they're in the Championship and because of who they are, pressure goes with a job. That's just the way it is. Dundee United fans can feel sorry, but nobody else in a Championship is going to feel sorry for Dundee United. They'll just go, look at the size of squad you've got, look at the amount of money you're paying your players. So nobody's going to feel sorry for Dundee United, so Dundee United have got to go on with the job in hand.
And there's absolutely no sense that anyone is asking for sympathy, which is the positive thing.
No.
Like, I think it would be easy for Jim Goodwin to come out and shrug and moan about teams coming and park the bus, but there's no sense of that. The conversation, he acknowledged that Dunfermline played in a certain way, but the conversation beyond that was largely about what Dundee United need to do better, and that needs to be the focus.
This is maybe also why he was happy to make so many changes last summer, because how many teams have we seen come down, retain a large chunk of the squad that got relegated? And they do feel, you see it at the start of the season, they feel sorry for themselves.
I think
they're like, oh, I want to be at Ibrox Parkhead Pataudry.
I think the need to change the squad came from Mr. Ogren, to be perfectly honest. So you did see that wage bill, didn't you, last?
I was trying to be positive. Talking to Mr. Ogren, he's over for the AGM. In a way, is he probably nipped a lot of the angst, if you like, in the bud by what he did a couple of weeks ago or so?
That would maybe be a fair summary, albeit I'm kind of loath to say so in case we leave this room and it turns out there was chairs thrown at the AGM.
I certainly don't think there'll be party poppers and party hats at the AGM.
There has been consequences and ramifications and reactions to relegation, which I think is what supporters would want. The sporting director's gone, the head of recruitment's gone, the whole recruitment department has been completely ripped up and needs to be rebuilt. The wage bill's been cut by a couple of million. Things that shareholders in that room would demand have been done. So there'll be a lot of questions about the future succession plans, whether Mark Ogren's looking to recoup a certain amount of money for his investments, all these things that supporters are interested in, stadium issues in terms of how much it costs to the upkeep of Tannadice and how much fans might be in the back of a recent survey asked to contribute towards that cause. There's a lot of things that I think the shareholders would be interested to hear from Mark Ogren and Luigi Capuano at the AGM, but as you allude to, I suspect if there is any residual anger about what happened last season, they will seek to point to people who have left the club as a sense of taking ownership of the mistakes. Albeit, I'm sure there will be a lot of people that would kind of point to Mark Ogren's culpibility in that as well.
It's a bit like the failure to break down that defence. He's been honest about it, but he could have done better.
Without being in Mark Ogren's head, I don't know what happened, but the season got away from him. It seems like, and before he knew it, he had clearly signed off on things that proved to be disastrous, and I'm sure he has a lot of regrets. I spoke to him last August, and you try to ask four or five questions, all angled towards digging into those regrets and mistakes, and he certainly isn't one for focusing on the past. He's got that quite American focus on the future and the next challenge, and you don't focus on the things you can't do anything about because they're in the past. But
and
at the same time,
you mentioned last August, they were on such a high. It's that old thing: the further you fall, the sorer it is when you land. But he's got up and got on with the journey, hasn't he?
Yeah, it certainly seems that way. So who knows what the vibe will be in the room. Will certainly be easy enough to find out after we finish recording, but I don't, as you rightly say, I think a lot of the consequences and repercussions that people wanted from last season have occurred. I don't think anybody can say that United have just shrugged their shoulders after relegation and kept the same personnel and kept the same methods and just went, oh, well, it'll be fine next time.
Yeah, the one question
there have been consequences.
He asked today is, and what have you done about it?
Exactly.
Because he has taken action.
Fans or shareholders will perhaps be angry, want to hear, what Mark Ogren was thinking last season, things like that. However, I don't think they can claim that there haven't been consequences following relegation.
And cross my mind, I suspect that Mark Ogren is too nice, too honest, too upfront. But a good old-fashioned Scottish chairman going into this AGM today, as soon as a player couldn't have been registered for last Saturday, anyone that Jim Goodwin had lined up, he would have said, well, just keep that for the AGM, son.
Well,
maybe that's what they'll do.
I might have Mr. Ogren. He might have left Scottish football.
He might have won in his hipper.
Yeah, that'd be nice. That'd be a good way to start the proceedings. But, anybody that's at the AGM, and if you go to these things, there are a few punters going out with a sense of anger. I would say, look at the man who is probably feeling the worst of all, be Mark Ogren. He's sitting with, he's pumped in north of 10 million quid, Tom, into this club, and they're currently sitting in the second tier of Scottish football.
I've never known an owner to get any sympathy for that from fans.
You're right, but that should
life's often hard and wrong, but that's just the way it is.
That should be remembered, moving forward. He would admit to making mistakes, of course, and everybody does make mistakes, but it's not... Everybody makes mistakes. It's how you go about it. It's how you respond. It's how you react to mistakes. You don't make the same mistakes twice. And I think he's doing that. And, United are in a situation now that, well, nobody likes to see them in the second tier, you know, but they're still spending more money than any other club in that league. There's no doubt about that, you know, but it's imperative to get themselves out of that. And that's where the pressure comes from. And fans inevitably think they should do better, especially at home. You would say that, unfortunately, that they haven't been fantastic at home this season. Their best form has been on the road. They've been decent at home, but they haven't been fantastic. And that's where they're getting 8,000 fans turning up most weeks. And you know, you were there, Alan, last week, and at full time, I believe there was a few boos ringing around the stadium. But I think, you know, the club is still moving in the right direction. The owner is still, he come out, you know, a few weeks ago, he's still committed, although he has sort of intimated that he's not here for the long term.
Forever, no.
Maybe he's been here, I think you said, Alan, he's probably been here longer than he will be in the future.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there could be moves afoot, but for him to sort of
get again, he doesn't realise how hard it is to sell a Scottish football club.
For him to get any sort of chunk of his money back, you've got to think that surely they've got to be in the top flight if there is going to be further investment coming in for him to find some sort of exit strategy. But while he's here, he's still committed to getting this club out of this division. I think that's a good thing.
And I have to say, I mean, when it comes to all their problems, I'm much more interested in what they're doing going ahead. For me, get promoted. He's shown that he's cut the budget. He's trimmed the workings of the club to an acceptable size and financially. And that's what I want to see just now. We can have a COVID-style public inquiry at United in the summer if you want, once they're promoted and once they're ready. But it is, and I think most fans are most concerned about what's happening on the park. And then if they get the home form tweaked so that they're getting 3 points every home game, keep their away form going, you're going to be happy.
I mean, they had their COVID-style inquiry in the summer. I mean, the notes within those accounts just absolutely, you know, albeit not mentioning names or anything, it basically filleted the you know, the structure and the decision makers from last season in its assessment of going over budget and several other aspects, you know, the club's communication, the club's everything about it.
You just wish they were that thorough a year or two before, eh?
You certainly do. Yeah, absolutely.
Really do,
and I don't have the same skin in my game as United fans do, so I'm assured that frustration will be there.
That whole, the way they've looked at the way the club was operating impressed and bemused me, because it was so thorough that I don't really understand why they weren't that thorough before. Maybe they go like this all. We'll get carried away with a bit of success, don't we?
But the key thing on that would be, how do you do a proper post-mortem on the way the club's been run when those that are running the club effectively are still there?
Yeah,
that's why. So the absences and the changes in personnel at the football club have allowed for them, those that remain, to take a step back and say, what did we do right, what did we do wrong, what were the problems? So they'll hope that those problems have been rectified, but you know, you're discussing looking to the future, and yeah, there's some really interesting things in that. Probably the key one would be, from a supporter's perspective, would be how do you rebuild that recruitment department. They're still, you know, they're looking for a head of scouting, whether you want to call that head of recruitment, whatever. I don't think a sporting director will be directly replaced, but nevertheless, they need a whole new infrastructure in that regard, and it will be very important should they get promoted going into next season.
And it's always an important thing that United, right down from kids level, because they've got such a rich tradition of producing players.
Yeah, fans are kidding themselves if they think that there'll be a big spend next season if they do get promoted. It will be done sensibly, and for that, I think they will need a bigger scouting network than just Jim and Luigi Capuano's contacts, which that is not me being sniffy. They've done a really good job in the last couple of windows, I think. However, you can see from the style of signings that it's been shopping in a limited pool. The signings have been sensible, if unspectacular, and very competent, and have done the job. But if you're stepping up into the top flight, you're probably going to need a bit more inspiration. Where are you going to find an Owen Beck? It's about having a wee bit of an expanded network, and I'm sure they'll look to have that recruitment side you know, rebuilt by, you know, touch wood, if they were to go back up. I think that's a really interesting one to keep an eye on.
Great stuff, guys. I mean, the only issue we've not covered this week are Jim Goodwin and Scott Brown going to tackle each other in the dugouts on Saturday just for old time's sake?
I think they're both going for that sort of we're sensible grown-ups rebranding, isn't it? It's funny because Scott Brown's kind of trying to do a Jim Goodwin, visibly. Like, yeah. Ever since he appeared in the...
Even grew hair.
I was going to say, it's like he grew hair, started speaking a little bit slower and a little bit... don't want to say posher, but like he's like he was very, very careful about how he was enunciating himself in interviews and stuff. And I was thinking, you're doing that thing that Jim Goodwin did, didn't you? You don't want to be that snarling player.
I like seeing Scott Brown snarling. Though. I think that's quite good.
I always liked Scott Brown for right back to his hips days. But I wouldn't like to be a player that's on the receiving end of a tackle on Saturday, because you could just see Jim Goodwin and Scott Brown going, that wasn't a tackle, son. Get off.
Stephen Whittaker's a nice guy as well. But really interesting to see how they both do it here at United. And Stephen Whittaker cut his teeth a bit in the coaching at Dunfermline. He's a good guy. So, from a non-United perspective, really interested to see how Ayr are looking when we go down there.
I have to say, one of the benefits of our job is you always got a wee insight into people. Because I mean, Scott Brown, Neil Lennon was another one. They would eat raw meat on the park or in the dugout. And this, but Neil Lennon, because you'd do it every game, and any time Scott Brown came in the press room, it would speak to the West Coast boys, they always came across as real, obliging, helpful, nice guys, which you should never just judge people as they were on the park. Except me, I was hopeless off the park and on the park.